I declare open the Standing Committee on Legal and Social Issues public hearing for the inquiry into the use of cannabis in Victoria.
We were spending time on law enforcement of low-level offences, low-level conduct that didn't need to be criminalised, and then at the same time failing to collect large amounts of available tax revenue that could be spent on other projects, so, and could be derived from a legal market.
We don't want to criminalize. I don't think it's a good idea to criminalize users. I don't think it's a good idea to give them criminal records to prevent them from becoming a full member of society if they've, you know, used cannabis. But I think there's maybe a middle ground to strike between sort of the extreme of criminalization, which is extreme, and what I would argue is the extreme of commercialization as well.
Is there any data pointing out whether those who are using or who have been using cannabis may graduate to, in a sense, to harder drugs?
A number of our states have very serious problem with opioid overdose and opioid use rates. And there's a body of evidence that's emerging that people are replacing some of that use with cannabis, and it's helping people reduce use. And there's some strong correlations between cannabis legalization and availability and overdose deaths going down in some of those states.
Have we got the data where we know what sort of impact the use of cannabis had on, overall health and mental health of the users, whether they are the young users or the adults?
There is a lot of research into that, and there is research underscoring that for some people who are vulnerable to having a psychotic episode, the cannabis could trigger it. But like at the same time, I don't think they've separated out or concluded that it's not, that it's causal.
You said that the various medical bodies are speaking out and talking about the dangers. And why isn't that being heard in these states when this issue is being put to the voters?
I agree with you completely on the perception issue. When we've done post-polling in certain states, we have found that people have absolutely no idea what 90% of these products are, that their perception is really that marijuana is a joint, maybe brownies or something, because their college roommate 30 years ago made brownies with THC in it, but nothing like the sophisticated levels of products that we're seeing today.
What sort of factors have led to the retention of those illicit markets in states where they're significant in the US?
What we've learned is you should have open doors. You should try and bring in and allow legal opportunity to as many as you can, capture as many people as you can under the umbrella of legal regulation and taxation, make it initially a very easy entry. And then as the illicit market becomes less viable, it goes away, at that point, then you can increase regulation, sort of increase taxation.
So what does regulate it in terms of the THC potency mean, or what does that look like in those states?
Yeah, a number of the states have the authorization, I think, to cap potency. I'm trying to think, I don't think any of them have put a cap on the potency of all products. There's
why,
a big
why
dialogue.
Why is that, do you think?
Yeah.
Why is that, do you think?
I think it's a number of reasons. One, I think there's the feeling still of competing with the illicit market, so not wanting to not make products that are currently available in the illicit market not available legally, that's gone through that regulation. So I think that's a piece of it.
These laws usually change by voter referenda. And voter referenda in the United States, which I don't think is a particularly great way to make policy. I think that this is a much better way to make policy. Have an open, a discussion with experts from multiple, sort of perspectives and weigh the pros and cons and contemplate it. I mean, this is very impressive, what you all are doing, and I really commend you for it.